Please welcome to the stage Paul Grewal, Chief Legal Officer at Coinbase, and Jeff Roberts, Executive Editor of Decrypt.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Jeff Roberts, Executive Editor at Decrypt. I'm thrilled to have Paul here. He's going to tell us a little bit about what happened behind the scenes for Coinbase's big direct listing and just some crypto gossip. So, Paul, thanks for coming.
Hey, Jeff, it's great to see you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so you're a public company now. How does it feel?
Yeah, honestly, Jeff, in a lot of ways, it feels very similar to how it felt as a private company. We obviously had a big moment several weeks back with our direct listing. But once the excitement wore off, we very quickly turned back to the business of building the crypto economy.
Good way to think. So, but tell us, what's like the upside and the downside? Because I think there's more paperwork, there's earnings calls. I mean, is that going to handcuff you at all or slow down your innovation? And conversely, what's the benefits of being public?
Yeah, I don't think we're going to see our innovation handcuffed in any way or slowed down. Life as a public company involves a lot of responsibilities, to be sure, and there are costs and burdens associated with that. More exacting reporting, for example, the SEC, more executive and other employee time involved in making sure that all of our T's are crossed and all of our I's are dotted as part of that reporting function. But at the end of the day, that's why we have an incredible team of finance experts, an incredible legal team that I help lead as well. Our job is to make that process as painless as possible for the people at our company, the product people, the engineers, the design people, who really are our keys to innovation.
Well, speaking of our friends at the SEC, the new chair spoke in Washington this morning, and he mentioned he might want to tighten up the crypto stuff. When you were listening to that, what did you hear? What's it going to mean for the industry?
Well, what I heard most of all, and perhaps loudest and clearest, is that there's going to be a lot of conversation about crypto in Washington and at the SEC over the next 4 years, and we welcome that conversation. I have been very public, and Coinbase as a company has been very public about the need for greater clarity on a number of key issues that the industry is facing. And so if this morning's discussion between ranking member McHenry and Chairman Gensler is a sign of things to come in terms of more focus and attention on those issues, we're all for it.
Yeah, because I spoke to Olaf Carlson-Wee earlier, the CEO of Polychain, and he was making the point with the rise of DAOs that if Washington doesn't get its act together, I mean, this stuff is just going to be distributed somewhere else, or it could be in Beijing or Singapore or Switzerland. Do you think that Washington is catching up?
Well, I think Washington is certainly paying attention. And I think one of the issues or one of the things that they're paying most attention to is the fact that crypto innovation is happening all over the world, not just in financial capitals like London and Singapore and others, but in little towns where developers with a great idea are now able to see their innovations get out to a wide, even a global audience. And so if that decentralization that's just native to crypto helps push traditional leaders when it comes to regulation or anything else to think more creatively and expansively about how to strike the right balance, I think it's a great thing.
Neat. Okay. Well, speaking of government people, I noticed the Coinbase put out a second transparency report and 4,000 law enforcement requests last year, which I don't think is crazy, but can you tell us a little more about that?
Yeah. So this is our second transparency report. The first one came out not long after I joined Coinbase at the end of August last year. And the basic idea behind the transparency report is to share not just with our users, but with the world at large, the extent to which law enforcement here in the United States and around the world makes formal requests for customer information from Coinbase. It's become now, I think, more standard in the tech industry to share that type of information. You see that from, for example, the Googles and Facebooks of the world and have now for some time. I thought it was very important that Coinbase lead the way in bringing that same accountability in crypto. And so that's why we moved to put those facts and figures out. As for what it means, what those numbers actually tell us, I think what it tells us is that law enforcement is paying attention as well to what's happening in crypto. And we're seeing a greater interest among law enforcement agencies globally in this type of information at the same time as the United States continues to lead in terms of the absolute numbers. So I think it's just, it's a good way for us to prompt a conversation about, you know, how companies like Coinbase should respond appropriately to these measures. And, you know, if we encourage that conversation, I think we'll have made a contribution.
Yeah, and I think people are praising Coinbase for the transparency, and certainly so. But one thing that's not in those reports is what Coinbase is doing in response. The FBI's knock on your door, says Homeland Security, says the Food and Drug Administration for some reason. But I know, you know, I used to cover Apple and Twitter and Google closely, and they would also sort of report how many times they refused and told the FBI to get lost. But Coinbase hasn't shed any light on this. So are you, you know, subpoena comes on your door, are you just saying yes, 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 rubber stamp? Or are you pushing back? Are you going to tell us?
No, we very much push back. You know, when we are served with any kind of request, informal or formal, our team's first response is to assess whether or not that request is being made to lawful authority. If the answer to that question is no, that's the end of the conversation. The answer to that question is yes, there is lawful process being served. We then work to evaluate what information is called for in response to that request and what information is not. So we very much focus on scoping our responses so that we provide whatever is compelled by law, but no more than that. You know, we say in our transparency report that, you know, we're eager to share more information about how often we respond to these things and provide more information more generally about our inbound. And I fully expect that we will do that in the coming months.
Okay, yeah, I think a lot of people would like to hear about that, because I know despite their controversial reputation, Twitter and Apple and Google have done a lot for civil liberties. And I know some are calling on the crypto community to do the same. So we might expect to see you guys taking a stand at some point, or it sounds like you are already.
Yeah. I think the calls are legitimate. And I think that, you know, one of the most important things we can do as a leader in crypto is to share our experience and talk about our practices. And that's one of the reasons why we kicked off the transparency report. It's why we're going to see more information in that report in the reports to come.
Okay, well, jumping around a bit, I've got another legal question for you.
Sure.
Earlier, but Coinbase has also announced that they are indeed going to be, you know, based nowhere starting next year. They're closing the San Francisco office, which is pretty bold. But I mean, how does that work in practice? I mean, you still need an office, right? Like, you know, how's that going to work?
We do need offices, and we will continue to have space for employees whose, you know, work situations at home are less than ideal and that really need a dedicated space to do their best work for the company. But it's, you know, it's an announcement and a transition we're making very purposefully and after a lot of careful consideration, in large part because we realized after experimenting like a lot of companies have over the last 12 months with remote work and work at home, that a headquarters is really antithetical to, you know, how Coinbase operates as a company and frankly what crypto is as a community. And so we thought it was, again, important for us to share what we're doing and provide, you know, lots of notice about this transition, not only to our employees but to the world at large. That, again, we hope we can establish ourselves as a leader and prompt some conversations about what it means to even have a headquarters in the 21st century or 22nd century.
Right, but you still have to tell the government where you're located, like, you know, this corporate filing.
They still know where to find us, Jeff, and that will not change.
Okay. Yeah. And I'm going to be asking Brian Brooks, the new CEO of Binance, this tomorrow, because they really like to say that, you know, CZ is nowhere at all. But, you know, I think you're right. You have to be somewhere. Anyways, let's talk a little bit about listings, because whenever Coinbase comes up, people are like, you know, when are you going to list this coin? When are you going to list, you know, that coin? How's that evolved? Is being public going to change that? What other coins are coming down the pipe?
Yeah, you know, Coinbase's approach to listings has evolved quite a bit. You know, like a lot of exchanges, we started out with just a very small number, even just one or two coins in the very earliest days, Bitcoin, then Ethereum. But we've now really, I think, seen that there is tremendous market appetite and demand for dozens, hundreds, perhaps even thousands or tens of thousands of coins looking ahead. And so we want to be the platform that offers consumers that choice of what coins they can purchase and where. Now, to do that in a compliant way, we need to follow the guidelines of the countries in which we operate. Here in the United States, it's very important that we evaluate whether assets meet our standards not only legally, but also in terms of our compliance and security requirements. And so we've actually been publishing more and more information to potential or actual asset issuers about what requirements they need to meet in order to come onto Coinbase as a platform. And hopefully in that way, we can encourage them to do that in a very responsible way.
Right. And sometimes you also delist people. You booted XRP earlier this year. Are they going to come back at some point?
Well, we paused our listing of XRP in the wake of the SEC's announcement of its enforcement action against Ripple. We're going to see how that litigation plays out. I think as best I can tell, we are still in the early innings of a nine-inning game in that case. But it's important that, you know, whenever we learn new facts and circumstances, whether it comes from the SEC or anybody else, that we evaluate whether our position needs to change. If yet more facts come out about XRP or that case resolves in a certain way, we very well may lift that pause. But until then, XRP is not trading on our platform.
Okay. I'm jumping around a bit here, but another hot topic in Washington and the country is antitrust. And
yes.
Coinbase, you know, you are the biggest company in crypto and you're getting bigger and you're eating smaller companies. And, you know, do you think, is that something you're going to have to worry about in the next couple of years?
Well, you know, I think we have a long way to go before our market in crypto looks anything like those markets that are being, you know, studied very carefully right now in Washington and in a number of courtrooms all over the country when it comes to big tech. The fact of the matter is that crypto is among the most dynamic and frankly intensely competitive markets of any industry out there. As you were alluding to earlier, decentralized platforms and offerings are coming up fast and furious. We are seeing emerging exchanges and other crypto intermediaries emerge outside of the United States. You mentioned Binance, for example. There are other strong competitors in markets from LATAM to APAC to Europe. And so I think the dynamics of our market are very different. Of course, if issues or concerns are raised from time to time, we'll address them. But I think at this point, the issue is not whether we have too little competition, but how do we respond to all the competition that we are facing?
Neat. But stick with antitrust. I'm going to ask you go a different direction. A little company called Apple you might have heard of.
I've heard of them, sure.
Court battle. It might even be in your old courtroom. For those who don't know, Paul was a federal judge who's then at Coinbase, which is pretty impressive and crazy. But they're in a big fight with Fortnite over, you know, monopolistic practices in the app store. But it occurs to me for crypto, you know, for all likes to be decentralized, we still all have phones, we still all have apps, and Apple is a huge gatekeeper. You know, they could start squeezing your revenue, they squeeze media companies' revenues, we hate that, or they could just boot you out. So, I mean, you know, is that something you've studied? I mean, how much of a threat is Apple to the crypto ecosystem?
Well, we pay a lot of attention to what's happening in the App Store on iOS and on other platforms, in large part because, like a lot of developers, we are subject to those rules, and to the extent those rules change or impose unfair burdens on us, that can pose a competitive threat. I think the most important thing to observe in the Apple litigation, and I haven't been in the courtroom every day as much as I would love to relive some fond memories from my past life. It seems that we have a judge, my former colleague, Judge Gonzales Rogers, who's paying very careful attention to the competitive dynamics and market definition issues that are in play in that case. And I think hopefully the public will take from that regardless of who they think is right and who they think is wrong in that case or any other, that we've got a federal judiciary that is paying careful attention and is equipped intellectually and otherwise to address and engage on these issues. And I hope that gives people some confidence that the right balance will get struck.
That's great. That's a pretty broad statement, Paul. I mean, I'm curious what's going to happen. I mean, what if apps want to put in, you know, options to pay directly with Bitcoin and things like that. And Apple has been really kind of, you know, hard-assed about not letting people, you know, add new payments and stuff. Is that something you've come up against? Or?
Yeah, look, we are always paying very careful attention to when the platforms on which our apps operate, impose burdens, whether it's payment systems, whether it's explicit prohibitions on crypto, or anything else that inhibit innovation in our industry. So do I think that that issue is going to continue to be a challenge for crypto going forward? I do, because these large platforms are not shy, as you've just suggested, in throwing their weight around. I, though, you know, ultimately am a long-term optimist because I think we've got a court system and a federal government that is quickly learning how to deal with these issues in a much more efficient way than they have in years past. So, you know, we'll have to see, but I think we've got the tools to deal with that if it should become a problem.
Same topic, but if I can ask you to sort of take off your lawyer judge hat for a second.
Yeah, sure.
But, you know, I mean, with dApps, you know, I'm still getting my head around some of the implications, but could that not pose a sort of existential threat to Apple in the long term? I mean, you know, you've got a decentralized application. Why do you need Apple or the App Store? And do you think that's something they're worried about, or does Apple even know about this?
Well, I think walled gardens become a lot less valuable to anybody when there's a way around the wall. And I think what dApps offer, among other things, is a way to circumvent a lot of the restrictions that have created or maintain those walls for Apple, for Google, and for every other major platform. So, you know, I think that for Coinbase, dApps are an opportunity because, again, to the extent it gives our users access to many more crypto services in the long run, we think that will benefit the industry as a whole. We think it'll benefit Coinbase itself. Will they create competitive challenges for others? Almost certainly. But we think these are ultimately good developments that will help the crypto economy flourish.
Right. And, you know, just to not repeat the question, but I mean, do you worry about Apple taking action to block dApp interactions, or is it too soon for that?
I think it's too soon to know what Apple specifically will do. I always worry when any element of the crypto economy is targeted by any powerful incumbent, whether that's a certain tech company in Cupertino or anybody else.
Well, who else keeps you up at night? I mean, it's your job to worry about Coinbase's legal problems, and you know there's a lot of threats to the company. So what else is top of your mind?
Well, what's maybe most top of mind for me isn't any particular legal threat in terms of a new rule or regulation coming out of Washington or a new lawsuit that might threaten our company, although we very much face those issues. I worry most of all that as a company, you know, we will find ourselves subject to so many burdensome regulations and rules that we will have to dedicate an ever increasing proportion of our resources to that effort and less to innovation. You know, my job, at least as I conceive of it, is to make sure that the people who are responsible for innovation have the freedom and resources to do the things that make the company great, make crypto great. To the extent that they're spending more time with me, more time with my team, I worry.
Fair enough. Well, speaking of innovation, speaking with Olaf earlier, who was Coinbase's first employee, he said he was kind of disappointed you guys didn't list, you know, Coinbase tokens on Coinbase where people could go redeem them somewhere for regular shares. And I know Fred, you know, your co-founder wanted to do that, and I think Brian did too, but you didn't. But you know, also sounds like someone had to take one for the team and just kind of get a public listing out the door. But you know, so when is Coinbase going to offer a token of its own? Will that happen this year or next year?
Yeah, I get the disappointment, and candidly, you know, there are a lot of us at Coinbase that are disappointed that we weren't able to offer that token as part of our transition to life as a public company. That said, that ideal very much remains a priority for us. I can't say when we will ultimately be able to do that. There are significant technical and regulatory hurdles that we still need to overcome. But it's still a dream that lives, and you know, we're going to keep working at it until we're able to do it.
Okay. All right. What else? Okay. Yeah. Well, tell me more about the IPO. Like, I mean, what didn't you expect? What was, you know, I mean, companies go public all the time, but you know, there's a lot of scrutiny of you guys. What went sideways? What surprises happened behind the scenes in that listing?
Well, you know, I think anytime any company goes through a transitional moment of that scale, you know, there are things that you don't quite expect. In our case, you know, for me, perhaps the most surprising element of the transition to life as a public company and the way that we did it as a direct listing as opposed to a traditional IPO was the public response to that creativity. You know, as lawyers, we don't always get to you know, claim a lot of credit for creativity, but you know, together with our finance partners, you know, we're very proud that we were able to be the first crypto company to go public in that direct listing way. And so the positive reaction, not so much from markets or from investors, but from people who care about crypto, was very gratifying. I think one of the great challenges any company faces in going through a process like that is that you have to explain your business in excruciating detail to a lay audience, whether it's a lay audience at the SEC or to the market as a whole. And crypto and Coinbase in particular, these are complex businesses that that we operate. And so having to articulate the fundamentals of how our business works, who our customers are, who we see as competition, all those sorts of issues, it's hard enough when you're selling widgets or plastics or industrial chemicals or whatever. It's even more challenging and difficult when you're talking about an industry that didn't exist, you know, a decade or more ago.
I imagine. But sticking with the going public, whose idea was it to put Satoshi's address on your your SEC filing on the S-1?
So that was a team inspiration, and a bit tongue in cheek to be sure. We wanted to pay homage to Satoshi as the man, woman, group, or other who is most responsible for what we've been able to achieve. It's interesting, Jeff. There aren't any specific rules at the SEC as to how you actually do that, and so. We made some history there by working with the agency to make that happen. In the same way that, for example, when Brian and Alicia Haas, our CFO, went on Reddit to answer questions submitted by regular Redditors and followers, that was, to our knowledge anyway, the first time that had been accomplished. So we were able to do some things that were innovative along the way, even if at the end of the day, as a legal team, we were there to make sure that the filing got done exactly right.
Yeah, the Reddit thing is pretty cool. I've covered IPOs for a long time in the tech sector, and that was one of the more fun ones. I'm going to ask you sort of a harder one, too. You saw last week Basecamp CEO tweeted out no politics at the company, and I know your CEO, Brian Armstrong, endorsed that, and that caused, a shitstorm that appeared in the New York Times. I mean, has Coinbase rethought this policy at all? Because I think skeptics would say that, saying no politics here is, in fact, a political statement. So, what's going on internally on that front?
I can understand why skeptics might take that view. This was not an easy decision that the company made last fall. And I think the public reaction and the challenges we faced publicly speak to that. But as we've looked back now with several months of experience operating in this way with our culture explicit for anyone to see written up in a document available to recruits or others who may be interested in learning about how life works at Coinbase, what we found candidly, Jeff, is that this entire approach has been a success. And the reason I think it's a success is that it's native to how Coinbase operates. It's native to the ethos Brian has set for the company. I don't know that it would necessarily work at other companies. In fact, I suspect that a lot of other companies it would not work. But I think having that range or option or set of options to choose from as a potential employee or otherwise is a good thing. And so that's how we're choosing to pursue it.
And I mean, but I'm going to push you a bit because crypto struggles with diversity, with bringing women into the sector and bringing people of color and Black employees in, and some of them quit over this. So I mean, do you think this doesn't put up a barrier that might discourage people from applying in the first place?
I think certain people might be discouraged, candidly, but I don't know that reaction is limited to any particular group or part of our community. I spend a lot of time at Coinbase, as I have for 25 years practicing law, working to diversify opportunities and roles for people. I'm very proud of the team I've built personally at Coinbase, and anybody poking around on my LinkedIn can see that for themselves. And I think that to the extent that people have questions about what kind of work environment they would face or find if they were to join Coinbase, we've been as public and as explicit as I think any company in industry about that. And I think that's our major contribution here. If others take a different view, God bless. I would encourage them to write it up in a blog post and have their CEO talk explicitly about it, because that way employees and potential employees have visibility and transparency, and that's the most important thing.
I guess that is one way to look at it, at least be upfront about what you're saying, aside from the sales. Just got a couple minutes left, but take us through the future bit of Coinbase. It sounds like you're telling me earlier that the going public has given you a new sort of war chest for M&A and stuff. Is that the case, and what sectors are you looking at?
Well, one of the advantages of being a public company is that you have a bit more flexibility to move quickly when opportunities present themselves. Coinbase as a private company has been a rather acquisitive organization and group. And this predates my tenure at the company, but certainly since I've joined, we have announced several acquisitions even before our public listing. I think as a public company looking ahead, you know, we continue to be very opportunistic about new markets, new opportunities here in the US and globally. And you know, the thing about crypto is there's just new innovation happening everywhere. We don't believe we have a monopoly on that innovation and or anything close to it. And so if there are groups of engineers and developers out there who have a better idea and they can use Coinbase to bring that idea to the masses, we'd like to make that happen.
Okay, and I'm gonna end on a note that just because it won't get out of the headlines, I want it to go away, but it won't. Dogecoin. What is your opinion on Dogecoin? What is Coinbase's, what's the party line at Coinbase and Dogecoin?
I don't know, we have a party line. What I will say about Doge is that the excitement that a lot of people have about it, I think, is hard to ignore. And the only other thing I'll say is that I look forward to seeing what Elon has to say when he's on SNL in a few days.
Yeah, everyone watch Saturday Night Live for Elon and break the internet. Okay, Paul Grewal, Toppler at Coinbase, thanks so much for joining us and for making the time.
Thanks, Jeff.